Good. So the topic of the summer term, already sweating. It will be warm. It's always in the summer term, it gets really warm then in the morning anyway. So the topic of the summer term are biophysical models for fMRI. And of course, this rests on all the stuff that you've learned so far about fMRI, and it also rests on stuff that you have learned about differential equations. I'm calling it biophysical models, which sounds as if we would go over like 10 different models, and they are all different, and we will discuss all of them. In fact, we will deal with one model class, but in this model class, you can create many different models. So in this sense, it's reasonable to call this whole thing biophysical models. I'm calling it biophysical models, although neurocognitive people or cognitive neuroscientists would understand much more what I mean when I would say DCM. DCM is an abbreviation for dynamical causal models, and yeah, they are one of the mainstream approaches to analyze fMRI and also EEG data. Why are they one of the mainstream methods of fMRI and EEG data? Because they're implemented in a toolbox, and SPM and neurocognitive neuroscientists, it's too much to really think about things. So they like to use toolboxes and apply things that other people have developed. These other people in this thing are actually the same people who also brought you the GLM for fMRI. So this is essentially Carl Friston's work around 2000, who branded the name Dynamic Causal Models in 2003. It's a paper in New Image called Dynamic Causal Modeling. The paper is okay-ish. It's maybe not the most didactic paper, but this is the whole idea of this kind of branding of things and then putting them into toolboxes. So you make sure that you, by not really explaining what this is about, but by making something that people can easily interact with without studying the methods, you of course are able to, first of all, maintain kind of the main competence about what you're doing, because nobody else can really understand what's going on, because you try to hide it a little bit. And then because it's in a toolbox, you also encourage its easy reuse. And then other people who say, oh, so if you're a young PhD student in a lab, you would say, yeah, it's cool, I learned about here biophysical modeling, and can I develop this? And then supervisors will say, no, I mean, this is all implemented. There's a toolbox, so just use the toolbox. This is all pretty bad. And that's the negative view on things. The positive view on things is that this dynamic causal models is essentially just biophysical modeling of fMRI data, given a new name in 2003. And the whole approach of doing biophysical modeling of fMRI data or any kind of data in neuroscience or cognitive neuroscience is, of course, a good idea, because it means that you can relate data to some biological connotations and interpretations. And this is, at least from a strictly neurobiological point of view, this is of course something nice. I can also already warn you, in terms of the cognitive stuff, dynamical causal models don't really give you anything. So they are biophysical models, yeah? They are not neurocognitive models, so they don't embed much about cognitive processes. They are biophysical models, so they focus on the biology and the physiology. But of course, in the long run, the aim is, at least my aim is, to bring cognitive modeling, so in terms of probabilistic learning, whatever, and biophysical modeling closer together, because that's essentially what everybody wants. But because everybody wants is just using toolboxes or neural networks, nothing happens. Anyway, this is the good news. So it's a neurobiological approach. And the other very good news is that it's a standard approach. So it's actually using, it's kind of a physics approach to things. You build a model that has some meaning. So it's not just like the GLM where you have regressors and effects and so on, but you have actually quantities in there that have some biological interpretation. For example, I don't know, synaptic strength or something like this. And you build this model, you formulate it in the standard language of science, which for one reason or the other are differential equations, non-autonomous actually in this case. And then once you've formulated it, you can basically generate data from this model. And importantly, of course, you want to have your data inform your model. And this is then the second aspect to actually DCM, and also the second aspect that we will discuss then at some length. So what DCMs and the biophysical models we will talk about are actually about joint distributions, probability distributions over data and parameters. So these p, y, theta, I could also write just data and parameters, because we will not specify at this point what y and theta actually are. So one specifies a joint distribution over data and parameter, and this is then really the model. So how this is usually done is that one specifies a likelihood function, so a probability distribution over the data given the parameters, and a prior over the parameters. And this likelihood function, and specifically its deterministic aspect, this is what we will spend the first third of the course on. So the likelihood function, we will briefly touch about the probabilistic aspects actually today, but we will then for the next sessions actually forget the probabilistic aspects, because the core of biophysical modeling is actually deterministic modeling. Unless you're a computational neuroscientist, then you say that you're dealing with ordinary differential equations, but when you simulate them, you always put some noise in, which means you actually have stochastic differential equations, but you don't call them stochastic differential equations. That's all a little bit weird, but here, and specifically in DCM, for experimental data where you had some external perturbations, so some experiment, it's non-autonomous ordinary differential equations, so there's no noise in the model itself. So it's a deterministic thing, meaning the likelihood function mainly is deterministic, and we will talk about the deterministic aspect at some at some length. The other thing is prior parameters, so the prior, and the easiest thing to think about priors in first instance here in this biophysical modeling view is that, of course, when you develop models with parameters, you sometimes want to fix some parameters. Of course, an important thing in model development is to figure out which parameters you can actually estimate from the data, which parameters you actually want to estimate from the data, which parameters you can inform from the literature, or you need just to fix, because otherwise you will not be able to estimate other parameters. And priors in this sense, specifically if you think, you say there's a high probability that this parameter takes on the value 4.3. If this is very high probability, so really, really high probability, and all the other values for this parameter have really, really low prior probability, then the data will not change this value much or at all, meaning that this actually corresponds to a fixed parameter. So priors in these kind of biophysical modeling approaches often actually play the role of giving a nicely statistically embedded way of fixing parameters. So this is actually the first part of the course, so discussing this likelihood function and specifically its deterministic aspect. What that means, we will talk about in a second. And then the second part which will be the latter two thirds, will be devoted to model. So this will be, of course, in my my world will be model formulation. So we will spend some time on formulating these models. And then we will spend some time on model estimation and evaluation, because after all, we want to be scientists and not computational neuroscientists. So we actually have to work with, or want to work with, the data. And this will, didn't check the microphone, anyway, now I checked it. This will relate to computing based on observed data and the model to compute the posterior distribution over parameters given the data, which allow for parameter inference. So to basically be able to say, okay, this and that parameter has a high probability to assume a value of, let's say, 6.3. Of course, conditional on the model that was formulated in the first step. And the other thing that we also want is to talk about the marginal likelihood, which is the probability of the data under the model averaged over the prior parameters, marginal likelihood, which is used as used for model comparison and relates to model evidence. So you want to say this model is better than this model because under this model, so under model A, the data have a higher probability to occur than under model B. So, and because this model is complicated, what we will use to this end, or what is actually always being used in DCM, this is also one of the reasons that DCM is so much magic for so many people, is that the model inference is actually done using variational Bayes, or as I call it, because I'm down with the kids, variational inference, which currently kind of in this, I mean, I think we're currently in this, in computer science and machine learning, in the phase where the neural network hype is starting to decline a little bit, but the still in terms of the neural network hype, variational Bayes got rebranded under the name of variational autoencoders. So if you look at NIPS, or you ask people what artificial intelligence is, then they would say neural networks. And then there are some people who also like to quantify uncertainty in addition, and they will say variational autoencoders. So that's all the same. So variational inference, variational Bayes, variational autoencoders is essentially all relates to the idea of approximating posterior distributions and using a kind of generalized likelihood function to do model inference. And this generalized likelihood function is called how? It's called free energy. So this whole thing, I don't know, I guess you didn't have any Londoners teaching you, so you didn't hear much about free energy principle, but some people were interested, you were interested, and you were interested. So this is also what is called free energy principle. So this is also why variational Bayes is interesting. Variational Bayes, if you are a little bit, know a little bit about Bayesian modeling, you, especially in psychology, you will have heard about JAKs, or what are these things called? These, just another Gibson, but there's something else, JAKs, and what's the other one?
Stan.
These things. So variational bass is essentially an analytical deterministic alternative to doing Bayesian inference in more complex models than the textbook models, and not using random number generators, but using essentially nonlinear optimization and some thinking. So it's not really important that you get much out of this at this moment. What I would recommend is that you definitely go over the introduction to probability stuff that I presented in this GLM course the year before you, because there and which you also find in the notes, because there I'm breaking down joint distributions, prior distributions, and conditional distributions to actually probability mass functions where you then compute them. We will look at this again in a continuous settings in the Gaussian case, then in the third part, and then these things of joint distributions, marginal likelihoods, and so on should get much clearer, so don't worry about this right now. But I wanted to give you the whole outline, and also in a way to emphasize that the problem, so the great thing about DCMs or DCMs for fMRI, that is biophysical modeling of fMRI data, the great thing is that they actually are up to date. So that's not like we use a t-test because in 1923 or whatever student published, if he was working in the Guinness Brewery, he published his t-distribution and we're still using it, and it's 100 years later and we haven't really made any progress. While DCM has basically originated from biophysical modeling of fMRI data or hemodynamic modeling, this is what I should say, it originated from hemodynamic modeling in the 90s, and then got embedded in variational Bayes, which is also just a 90s and early 2000s approach for doing model estimation. And it's a standard thing. It's a little bit up to date. So it's not neural networks like they were in the 80s, and now we call them deep learning, and they're still the neural networks. So it's actually modern stuff, and it's interesting. And this is the most important thing of the whole exercise here, is that I try to show you what can be done if you want. So neurocognitive or neuroscience, cognitive neuroscience, doesn't mean that you have to use toolboxes, click around stuff, are not allowed to think about stuff, are not allowed to be creative, but you have to use models that other people develop. And there is only the drift diffusion model and MVPA. There is a lot more, and you can do whatever you want. You just need to develop the skills and indulge yourself in the whole thing. Then you can do whatever you want. And as an example for that, that's what I'm using these biophysical models in the summer term for. Good. So. After this, I think it's called pep talk, I think we can start. Other questions right now? No. Good. Then let's really start with biophysical models for fMRI. I think, actually, for the rest of the course, I will call them always DCMs for fMRI. But this is more because it's I was raised like that. And it's a little bit hard to get that out of the system, but the whole topic is biophysical modeling, and once we are at the details and so on, then I think it's a lot easier to detach from this term DCM for fMRI, because then it's easier to say, okay, now this is general biophysical modeling, but if we haven't really started and I'm given an introduction, I will stay with DCNs for fMRI. By the way, there's also dynamic causal modeling for EEG, or let's say biophysical modeling for EEG data. What I want to do is that you have this advanced neuroimaging methods course in October, and I used to give a EEG fMRI lecture for a couple of years back, and I'm a little tired of that because it's always the same lecture and it hasn't really changed for 5 years or so on. So I will talk to Felix, because what I want to do is to teach the DCN for EEG in your winter course. So this is also in this October course. So there will be basically part two of biophysical modeling in October, or whenever Felix plans to do his course for EEG. But right now we're doing the fMRI stuff. Good. Now, DCN for fMRI. So what is the whole thing about? So the whole thing is about, I think I've briefly mentioned that previously, is that you acquire fMRI data, and you all know what you obtain in one run. Where's the run person? There's somebody who's Yanis. sorry. sorry. In one run, you acquire fMRI data, and what you get is a time course of the MRI series for one voxel, right? So you all know that right now, so I don't want to go over that again. Now you do that if you do that for one run and all voxels, of course you have many time courses all over the brain. At the same time, when people are in the scanner, you present certain conditions. You've already seen that in terms of the GLM. Yeah. So this would be one voxel here, and this would be one experimental condition onset. Now, of course, you can go and do a GLM analysis of this data. There's nothing actually against that. And then if you read, for example, Clive and Stefan's 10 simple rules for fMRI, because we have to give you simple rules because you are not smart, so you need simple rules, because complex rules you really won't understand. Well, they didn't say that, I said that. What they actually recommend is that you first do a GLM analysis and then you do a DCM analysis. Yeah, you can also just not do a GLM analysis and just do a DCM analysis, although you want to actually, in a way, make sure that somehow the time courses you're looking at showed some covariation with the experiment, otherwise the whole thing wouldn't really make much sense. Anyway, so you could do a GLM analysis now, but you can also do biophysical modeling. And that means you want to explain observed time series data, not just with regressors that are convolved somehow with your hemodynamic response function, because you might also think, yeah, I mean, whatever. I mean, why this hemodynamic response function? Why these gamma parameters? Why voxel-wise statistics and so on? Why do we not model the data basically as being generated by some underlying neural activity, some neurovascular hemodynamic processes, and then the observation by the MR machine? Why not model this whole process and let's see where we get? And this is, in a way, the idea. What the focus then is on, although this has changed a little bit over the years, but we will still do that in this way, because it's still the main approach that is being used, is that you define regions of interest. Yeah? So now again doing mass univariate analysis of all voxels in the brain, you say, okay, yeah, there are different parts in the brain, but for my experiment, for example, where I presented a visual stimulus and then people did a response to that, I'm actually more interested in how visual cortex, parietal cortex, and temporal cortex interact and how they contribute or how they behave, let's say, under this experimental task. So the idea then would be to say, okay, let's focus on three regions of interest here. Of course, these regions of interest have multiple voxels in them. So what we do is that we essentially just collapse all these voxels onto one time series. So we average over space. And then get three time series. So maybe let's put that here. Da, da, da. So let's say we have a visual area, so V1, we have a parietal area, intraparietal sulcus, and we have a temporal area. I don't know whether it's a temporal area, but I see it sometimes TE when vision people talk about the brain, I think. Also see it, of course, as echo time. Anyway, but this is an area. And we have, from one run, we have the data from these regions of interest averaged over voxels. Something like this. And then, of course, this whole thing is, the resolution here is TRs. So you have discrete sampling time points, and yeah, depending on how this was done, let's say there's a TR of, let's say, 2 seconds. That is really not important right now, but that's kind of the time resolution. And so this is some data. Now, the whole idea of analyzing these data in DCM, or the whole idea of DCM for fMRI, is actually to focus on these three time series. Of course, there are a couple of things that one can say already. Of course, you can do that for multiple runs. You can also do it for multiple subjects. There are different ways to combine that. We will focus actually on the single run because the model mechanics apply in the same way to a single run as they do to multiple runs when it comes to the biophysics. Now, this essentially is the data. So why the GLM approach looked at the time series from all voxels all over the brain. This actually just uses a subset of the fMRI data, and it uses exactly something like this. Now, there have been, essentially this is what people do. I put one paper from, I think, 2019 into the summer term folder on DCM for fMRI, which is a user paper, the PNAS paper on biological motion detection, so that you can also see how this is being used. And this is exactly that. So there are a couple of regions, and then they are being analyzed. There have been some generalizations, basically a lot of people always say, oh, three regions, so can we have more regions? Then it's like, yeah, but then the algorithms don't converge. But there have been some improvements on that. So I think, and then there's some people who think, oh, we could do a DCM with all, we can use every voxel as a region, and then we have a DCM with really many regions. And yeah, you can do all of that. The origin was and is still being used is that you look at 5 regions of interest. How do we identify these regions of interest? Well, this whole thing is hypothesis driven, so you should have an idea of what you're doing and why you are doing it. There are no rules for selecting regions of interest. So you need to motivate them from what you know already, from the literature, whatever. Then the question is, so how do I, for a specific person, now define the regions of interest? And yes, you can do whatever. So you either say, okay, I take an anatomical coordinate, some MNI coordinate, and I take this for all people, make a sphere around it, take the data from that. Or I look in each person whether they have some activation and some basic contrast, and then I kind of look at the overlap between my anatomical region of interest and this contrast. There are no rules. Isn't that a song? It's Dua Lipa, right? No, new rules. There are not new rules. No rules. It's a little bit of an old song. You won't know this anymore. So there are no rules. And although there's a lot of discussion on these kind of things. So whenever you find these discussion on the SPM email list, or there are two new tutorials on DCM by Peter Zeitmann, who is, I think he's a nice guy, and he has two new tutorials on DCM for FMI. And a lot of the focus on this is always on these kind of, from my perspective, a little bit mundane aspects of the whole thing, that you know, which region and so on. The thing is, this is where the whole thing only starts, and then the interesting stuff happens. So you need to somehow define what your data is, and you have some degrees of freedom in terms of defining what your data is, because you acquired more data than you actually need, because you acquired, usually you acquire whole grain data. On the other hand, if you would do, I don't know whether something like this is possible, but if you would use surface coils, definitely you can look at, you can get better signal from small regions, and if you would have three surface coils, then you might only have three regions anyway. So yeah, whatever. That's how regions are being selected. Then the most important thing in terms of the rhetoric about DCM for fMRI is that it's about connectivity. So why is this interesting? It relates to what I also ask you a lot in terms of cognitive subtraction. It relates to these notions, which are actually helpful, of functional segregation versus integration. And integration. And as you will remember, functional segregation refers to the idea that a brain area has some specialized function. And on the other hand, functional segregation is the outcome of a mapping analysis like GLM or MVPA. Functional integration refers to the interaction of brain areas, and the way that DCM was essentially introduced to the new imaging literature was as a method to study functional integration, so to study a specific form of connectivity. I will give you this in a second, namely effective connectivity. These are terms that are just there, and I recommend, maybe I'm not doing the best job by reiterating them, because it would be better if they were forgotten, but hear about them and never use them. So functional connectivity is a term that exists in the fMRI literature. And then the next sentence, if you read somewhere functional connectivity in this kind of thing, talking about connectivity types and then relating it also to effective connectivity, the next sentence after the sentence functional connectivity, or after the word functional connectivity, is always relates to the statistical dependencies of time series. So what people mean by functional connectivity is essentially what also what resting state people would do now. I mean, we know, I made this explicit here, but we know that there was an experiment performed. So there were some events, at least of one condition. Let's say this was not performed, or we just are so much into our resting state analysis that we just forget about this. And then we want to do functional connectivity. So what we can do is compute pairwise correlations. So I hope you remember from undergrad statistics a little bit how to compute correlation coefficients. So essentially you multiply the data points that you acquired, and then and then you add up things, and that's essentially your correlation coefficient. So you could essentially in this case compute the correlations coefficients between all areas. Of course, with itself it correlates best, and then don't see much here, so let's be very optimistic. So there's a correlation of 0.7, and this is maybe smaller, and this is maybe, I don't know, and then of course it's symmetric, because correlations, and if A correlates with B, B also correlates sensibly with A. So you can do these correlation matrices. This is what resting state people do. Sorry, this is also V1, IPS, TE. And so you have correlated this in terms of correlation coefficient. So that's correlation coefficient, rho. And then you have this matrix, and then, yeah, you can, what people nowadays like to do is to plot these matrices. So then you have these square things in papers, which are just very colorful. And then what they also like to do is then to apply graph theoretic measures, which, yeah, why not? But of course, graph theory was not developed to study biological systems. So it, you then come up with things like, there are then all kinds of measures that are more or less good to describe graphs. So these kind of usually then also binarized connectivity matrices. And then you get measures, and that's like me doing my PhD thesis on information theory. You get some numbers out of that. I get out conditional mutual information and synergy or whatever. And then you have these numbers and say, oh, that's very interesting. What does it mean? Let's come up with something. And the same way you come up with things once you did these graph analytical things, and then you say, oh, this might mean this and that. But then normally you would say, okay, somehow now I have to interpret all these numbers. Maybe I should build into my data analytic manner something that gives me the interpretation already. Then I have less work and I can go home and don't have to come to uni at 8 o'clock and being locked in a room. I was locked in a room this morning. Anyway, that's a different story. Effective connectivity. So that's functional connectivity. This is very interesting. It's all the resting state people. Yeah, it's a little bit boring. So we not talk about this. We talk about effective connectivity, which is just a fancy term that adds to the layer of myth and mystic over DCMs for fMRI. So effective connectivity is defined, Preissel in 1991 or something like this. This is always the reference, as the effect one neural system has over the other. So the thing is then what happens is the terms. So effective connectivity you measure with DCM. So this is just all talk, and one doesn't really know what this is about. But yeah, be aware that people run around and say, so are you doing functional or effective connectivity? Then you say, well, I'm doing biophysical models for fMRI. And then they're like, what? No, you have to do DCM or functional connectivity. So what are you doing? This is just another word for DCM. It wants to say that it's doing a little bit more than correlation. So this is, I think, what the biggest implication of this is, more than correlation. There's actually, there was for some time the Granger causality versus DCM debate, one of these awesome debates. This is a different way to study dependencies. It's again more of the correlative nature, but it's not as simple as just doing time point by time point correlations. It basically is based on autoregressive modeling. So Granger causality, we also not talk about this. So we talk about effective connectivity, which is more than correlation. Biophysical modeling, that's what we talk about. And then the way these things are done, essentially, to also give you an idea of that, is that there's SPM, and you're supposed to click on things, and then what you're supposed to specify are connectivity prototypes or whatever. And then what this whole modeling initiative ends up with in papers are always kind of pictures like this. That describes somehow the model space. So there would be something like this, and there would be something like this. And sometimes there's a condition influencing something here, and then there would be a graph with some model comparison, and then saying, okay, this model won. But it will not talk about what the models are actually about, whether these models actually work, whether they are sensible models. But they will be, yeah, this will be the thing that you see in a paper about the method. And then in the methods section, you will read, so standard method to study effect of connectivity. And it will not really explain much. So this is what you see in DCN papers, and this is why a lot of people never get started with DCN, because it's really, if you read these DCN papers, you first think, what are they doing? And you think, what? Yeah, sorry, that's all I ever get from these DCN papers, these user papers. And you, yeah, so you really have to look behind the curtain of these models to get what they are about. Okay, before we then start with some formal stuff, I think three more points about DCMs that I find really important. I try to, what should be clear now is that these are models for time series of a number of regions of interest. So NR is the number of regions of interest. So time series, let's say three or four time series. Regions of interest are often also abbreviated ROIs. And so now what are they? And they are these biophysical models, these DCMs, they are the following. They are dynamic biophysical models which I haven't talked about the causal stuff, so forget about the causal. Yeah, we can talk about what is causal about them, but this is that always depends on what your notion of causality is. So for the moment, don't think in cognitive neuroimaging you're only allowed to say causal when it's TMS. Then you say, yes, TMS is causal, because in the end we correlate where we set people with how they behave. And because we do a correlation of the TMS with the behavioral data, this is causal. Because we do correlations, and as everybody knows, correlations are causal. This is how people talk about TMS, which I find always very weird, because they really believe that TMS is something causal when in the end they do the same correlations. Anyway, so it all depends on your notion of causality, and the notion of causality in DCM is a completely different notion of causality as compared to the notion of causality in TMS. So causality we will come back to. Dynamic biophysical models, that is where I currently was. They are dynamic biophysical models, by which I mean they use differential equations, and for the moment I would say ordinary differential equations. So they are ordinary differential equation models with physical connotations. So the best or the most popular with physical connotations, the most famous connotations, ordinary differential equation system of second order that everybody knows is of course Newton's law, which is F, so force being equal to mass times the second derivative of position, also known as acceleration. So this is a typical ordinary differential equation model with physical connotations. It's a second order ordinary differential equation. So you have acceleration in there. And of course you have very strong physical connotations here. You have something that moves, it has a velocity that changes, so it's accelerated. You have mass, which you are very experienced with, so and you have force, which is kind of this weird thing in physics, like force and energy. These are just latent things that are used to explain things, but you can never really pinpoint, or I can never really pinpoint what, and I think physicists, nobody knows what energy really is. It's a latent construct to explain things. Anyway, so this is what I mean by they are dynamic biophysical models, ordinary differential equation models with physical connotations. A very important thing now, because I'm so sick of MVPA. this is these are multivariate models. So this is MVPA. Multivoxel, let's say, yeah, multivoxel. If we take from each region, we take just one voxel, then it's a multivoxel. Otherwise, it's a, of course, an average over voxels multi-region pattern analysis. But so it's multi-region pattern analysis, or if you from each region just take one voxel, then it's actually multivoxel pattern analysis. In which sense multivariate? Well, in exactly the same sense as MVPA is a multivariate method, namely that the data that you have for each time point or for each presentation of a condition is not a single number like it was in GLM, where we use the massive univariate approach, but it's more than one number. So in the example that we did here, so for each time point here, you have a vector of the values that represents the value at V1, IPS, and TE. And then at the next time point, you again have a pattern of voxel activations, V1, IPS, and TE. So you have a time series of these region activation or voxel activation patterns. You can, one can also, if one wants to, of course, instead of having regions interact with one another, have the voxel patterns of these regions interact one with one another. One just needs more latent states for that, and can all be done. Hasn't really been done, but it's a multivariate model, and it's much better than standard MVPA, because standard MVPA would be, as you might have learned from all these strange EG classification talks that are always happening, is that you try to learn some function without any biological or neurobiological or cognitive connotation that maps your condition labels to these patterns. This is, and then you say, oh, this can be learned and it's better than 50%, 53.6. I mean, this is not better, so let's not make fun of the small effect sizes. That depends on how you do your DSM and what you really have and blah, blah. But anyway, so the thing about this multivariate aspect of DSM is that instead of having a function that maps condition one to this kind of pattern, condition two to this kind of pattern, you actually, and this function is being used as a black box, you actually explicitly specify the function that maps your conditions onto the pattern of voxel activations and their evolution. So it's a multivariate model. It's MVPA deluxe, royal. Yeah. So that's actually, this is really important. And then going, and this is actually important because a lot of people get so hung up on this MVPA machine learning hype and this blinky blinky pictures with these patterns, that if then one talks about DCM for FMI and biophysical modeling, it's like, oh, differential equations, isn't this what some nerdy physicists do? We do MVPA, blink, blink. So I want to work a little bit against that. So this is, it's definitely better than standard. This is why I mean, I did classification when I was like your age or so. And then I decided, well, this cannot be the end of the world. So let's look what else there is. And then the next step would be these kind of models. This is also not the end of the world, but it's one step into a good direction. And then in the end, and this is also important, this also, of course, goes far beyond what standard MVPA in cognitive neuroscience is doing, it's that these are probabilistic models, because they, as I already mentioned, are embedded. So they allow for uncertainty quantification, which multivariate pattern analysis in the classifier sense doesn't really do. So that you get your, that's it, or at least it does in some very intuitive way, which in maybe in 20 years or so will be formalized, and then it may be something that is actually something real. Right now is just, let's classify. So let's take a break now. And after the break, start with looking at this in more detail. And we start again at 9:10.